Mr. Wall, many thanks for making time to speak to us. Just yesterday, we heard from Justice Henry Peter Adonyo that he had ruled that credit facilities issued by DTB Kenya offered to Chigundu Hamis, of course, are illegal since it's not a licensed bank in Uganda. Give me, just very briefly, have you seen this particular ruling?
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me this evening. Yes, there was a development yesterday, a ruling made, that quite frankly took the industry by surprise. We have not seen the detailed judgment as yet until up to today, but it took the industry by surprise because we thought the facts were fairly clear, but also the ramifications of the judgment across the economy, across the banking sector. We are very optimistic that we'll get the details. And like we issued in our statement this morning, that we will join DTB in pursuing an appeal as well as a stay of execution as the matter is reconsidered.
Right. We're to talk more about your statement, because you've come out as the association and made it very clear the portfolio that the banks and this particular financial institutions are sitting on is north of what, $1 billion. Give me a sense of what the implication could be if this went south, to put it plainly.
Yes, thank you very much for that. $1.5 billion, to be more precise, or $5.7 trillion, and that's the book seated only in commercial banks, leave alone the lending to government, which we didn't indicate there. As you may know, government is one of the biggest beneficiaries of loan syndication. And so what the judgment, from the little that we have seen so far, indicated that certain lending structures are illegal because the counterparties, the foreign lenders who participated in the transaction, were not licensed as such. It was an illegality. Again, our lawyers and legal teams will argue this case, but the loan structures all over the world are done when funding is not sufficient, when the amounts are big. As regulated institutions, the regulator has limits under which you lend to one single person for purposes of managing risk, so that when that business goes bad, your entire banking industry doesn't collapse because of too much exposure to one individual. And it encourages that you share risk by contributing to the lending amount.
It's very interesting when you mention it like that, because, well, we know, if you've, well, financial people might know this, tranches, you know, yeah. And then you create alpha and beta on one side by spreading your risk. Yes, I understand. But is this a loophole then? Because the argument that is put forward by Diamond Trust Bank is the fact that Diamond Trust Bank Kenya is acting as an agent to this particular transaction. Now, is this information that Mr. Chigundu needs to know prior to signing the dotted line, or is it just a loophole that is being exploited?
I think it's not even a loophole. It is a diversion from the way we see it. Let's look at the particular structure in this case. It is argued that this particular borrower borrowed directly from Diamond Trust Kenya. Fine. Two important things we need to understand. What banking is and borrowing. Borrowing is part of the banking services, but not entirely everything about banking. And therefore, you can borrow from anywhere in the world and bring some money to do some work here. That's fine. And all borrowing doesn't have to be licensed by the central bank. And you can indeed borrow from Kenya. Once you borrow there, because the lender in Kenya doesn't have presence here, it will appoint an agent here and say, when you are repaying the loan, pay it through Bank A. And for that service, Bank A is offering, they will earn a commission. In this case, the two DTBs are sister companies, and therefore, naturally, they preferred their own. And most likely, the recommendation must have come from the DTB in Uganda, because they know the customer, they have his history, they have his securities.
But of course,
now, in that case,
yeah, yeah.
There is no illegality in borrowing from Kenya.
But his argument is 34 billion Uganda shillings that are charged that he was oblivious to. Now, how does the Bankers Association react to such an allegation that someone's account was deducted north of 30 billion Uganda shillings and he was oblivious to that particular deduction?
Absolutely. And when you sign any loan agreement, there are terms, conditions which you sign, and they never arose at the point of signing. It is at the point of default that these issues start coming in. And there is every opportunity to go through the agreement, including arbitration, to avoid this. But those are legalities that the legal teams will go in. I think more importantly is that the framework to look for money anywhere is all right, it's not illegal. In any case, if that was not the particular structure, if Diamond Trust had to participate in it beyond what we call its single obligor limit, either way, the regulator will always be aware of these transactions. And in this particular case, we've had a session with the central bank today, and they will be joining this particular appeal and put their case and also help the courts understand certain regulatory aspects. But I think more importantly is the ramifications of the ruling, because these structures are allowed to mobilize more funding for the various development projects, for private sector-driven initiatives.
Do you see this having an implication on our credit rating?
Absolutely. It has risk. Information travels. Yeah. It affects the credit rating of the country. And by extension, it paints us in very bad light, especially as an investment destination. And yet capital flow is what this country needs. For Christ's sake, we are just going into opening up the oil and gas sector, energy in the country, road infrastructure, and so on and so forth. We need more capital than ever.
Mr. Owo, before I let you go, has the central bank made their position clear? You've mentioned that you did have a...
Yes, we've had conversations with them, detailed ones, both yesterday, today. They will be issuing a statement as well, based on the meeting we had this morning. And once the details, I'm not speaking for them, but once they indicated to us in the meeting that once the detailed judgment comes out, their legal teams will look at it and see how best to play whatever role they are going to play in this matter. We've also drawn the attention of the Minister of Finance. Again, as I said, government is the single biggest beneficiary of syndicated facilities. I'm not sure where this judgment leaves them, and we have requested that they pronounce themselves that they will continue to honor syndication obligation.
Well, there's a pipeline in order, so that might be thrown in the...
No, because you see, member banks have participated in syndicating loans to government, and this particular judgment puts that at risk. And therefore, there's a lot of uncertainty. The whole of last night, the various syndication partners across the world syndicating loans with other banks were calling and saying, what does this mean? What happens to our facilities? Very, very, very most unfortunate that happened.
Mr. Owo, many thanks for making time to speak to us.
Thank you very much. Yeah?